Archette Audio presents The Trial of Henry Kissinger, written by Christopher Hitchens, read by Simon Prebble. When this little book first appeared, in what may now seem the prehistoric spring of 2001, it attracted a certain amount of derision in some quarters, and on two grounds. A number of reviewers flatly declined to believe that the evidence presented against Henry Kissinger could be true. Others, willing to credit at least the veracity of the official documents, nonetheless scoffed at the mere idea of bringing such a mighty figure within the orbit of the law. It says nothing for the author, but a great deal about the subject, to be able to report that the lapse of just 1 year has brought important and incriminating new disclosures and seen significant new developments. To begin with the disclosures, then, one might instance fresh and conclusive evidence under four of the headings originally discussed here: Indochina, Latin America, East Timor, and Washington, D.C. And to follow on with the legal developments, one can now cite important proceedings brought against Kissinger in four democratic countries, including his own. I hope I will not seem to boast if I say that most of these disclosures and initiatives were foreshadowed in the first version of this book. At any rate, they now appear here, and any listener may judge by comparison with the unaltered original text. Indochina. Further material has come to light about both the origins and the conclusion of this terrible episode in American and Asian history. The publication of Larry Berman's No Peace, No Honor, Nixon, Kissinger, and Betrayal in Vietnam in early 2001 provided further evidence of the secret and illegal diplomacy conducted by Nixon and his associates in the fall of 1968. Indeed, it can now be safely said that the record of this disgusting scandal has become, so to speak, a part of the official and recognized record, rather as President Johnson's original provocation in the Gulf of Tonkin is now generally called by its right name. In his edition of President Johnson's private papers and conversations in the fall of 2001, Professor Michael Beschloss produced first-hand and direct proof that Johnson himself knew at the time that he was lying to the Congress and the world about the episode. As for the expiring moments of that hideous war, the month of May 2001 saw the publication of an extraordinary book, The Last Battle, The Mayaguez Incident, and the End of the Vietnam War. Written by Ralph Wetterhahn, a Vietnam veteran who had decided to stay with the subject, the book establishes beyond doubt, by the use of contemporary documents and later interviews, that A. The crew of the Mayaguez were never held on Koh Tang Island, the island that was invaded by the United States Marine Corps. B. The Cambodians had announced that they intended to return the vessel, and had indeed done so even as the bombardment of Cambodian territory was continuing. During that time, the crew was being held on quite another island, named Rong Sam Len. The statements of Ford and Kissinger, claiming credit for the eventual release and attributing it to the intervention on the wrong island, were knowingly false. C. American casualties were larger than has ever been admitted. 23 men were pointlessly sacrificed in a helicopter crash in Thailand that was never acknowledged as part of the operation. Thus, a total of 64 servicemen were sacrificed to free 40 sailors who had already been let go, and who were not and had never been at the advertised location. D. As a result of the official panic and confusion, three Marines were left behind alive on Koh Tang Island, and later captured and murdered by the Khmer Rouge. The names of Lance Corporal Joseph Hargrove, PFC Gary Hall, and PVT Danny Marshall do not appear on any memorial, let alone the Vietnam Veterans Wall. For a long time, their names had no official existence at all, and this denial might have succeeded indefinitely were it not for Mr. Wetterhahn's efforts. Kissinger was the crucial figure at all stages of this crime and cover-up, arguing at the onset of the crisis that B-52 bombers should at once and again be launched against Cambodia, and arguing too for the dropping of the BLU-82 bomb, a 15,000-pound device on the centre of Koh Tang Island. He must also have been crucial in the following hair-raising episode made public by William Triplett in the official publication of the Vietnam Veterans of America. Mr. Triplett interviewed then-Secretary of Defense James Schlesinger, who recalled two cabinet meetings during the crisis. The first was the one at which Kissinger demanded the use of B-52s. The second was the one, no less alarming to Secretary Schlesinger, at which it was decided to sink all ships spotted in the vicinity of Koh Tang Island. As Schlesinger recalled it, "When I got back to the Pentagon, I said that before any ships are sunk, our pilots should fly low over the ships and see what they could see, particularly if there were any Mayaguez crew members aboard. If they did see them, they were to report back immediately before doing anything. In the course of flying over the area, one of our Navy pilots called back saying that he saw Caucasians aboard a ship, or he thought he saw that. It later turned out that every member of the Mayaguez crew was on that ship." Question: did you apprise the White House of this ship with the Caucasians aboard? Answer: yes, indeed. Question: and was it then that the White House said to sink it? Answer: yes. The White House said, "We told you to sink all ships, so sink it." By stalling for 3 hours, the Secretary of Defense managed to avoid committing this atrocity. And by the White House, he clearly does not mean the President, or he would have said so. In any case, we know who was managing the Mayaguez rescue, and who took credit for it at the time. We're sure to learn even more about Kissinger's hands-on policy in Indochina, as still more officials write their memoirs or make their confessions. Latin America. The documentary record on Chile is now more or less complete, but much remains to be discovered about Kissinger's role in Operation Condor, and in the nexus of dictatorship and repression which gave it birth. Recent published work by Martin Edward Anderson and John Dingus in the conservative Washington magazine Insight in January 2002 has presented us with incontrovertible proof of high-level approval for Argentina's dirty war of death and disappearance in the mid-1970s. The evidence here might be described as unimpeachable, since it originates with a senior member of the Argentine dictatorship and an ultra-conservative United States diplomat. The first man, Admiral Cesar Guzzetti, foreign minister of the Videla dictatorship, had a dispute about both means and ends with the second man, U.S. Ambassador Robert Hill. Ambassador Hill was a Cold War veteran with tight family connections to the business oligarchy in Latin America. A Nixon appointee to the Buenos Aires post, he had also served contentedly as envoy to a number of despotic right-wing regimes. However, he was appalled by the campaign of murder unleashed in Argentina after the 1976 military coup, and became distressed by the way in which Kissinger, from Washington, undercut his representations on the matter. To those familiar with the Chile investigation, in which a two-track policy was pursued, and the officially accredited ambassador is not supposed to know of the real or covert policy, this may seem unsurprising, but not to Hill, an old school type, the declassification of whose cables furnishes much of the new material. Before Admiral Guzzetti travelled to Washington to see Kissinger in October 1976, Hill had met him and told him that murdering priests and dumping 47 bodies in the street in one day could not be seen in the context of defeating the terrorists quickly. On the contrary, such acts were probably counterproductive. What the USG, United States government, hoped was that the GOA, government of Argentina, could soon defeat terrorists, yes, but as nearly as possible within the law. Even this admonition, which might be seen by some as containing a loophole or two, was considered too harsh by Kissinger. Guzzetti set off for Washington, Hill subsequently minuted, fully expecting to hear some strong, firm, direct warnings on his government's human rights practices. However, having met Guzzetti on his return to Buenos Aires, he concluded, "Rather than that, he, Guzzetti, has returned in a state of jubilation, convinced that there is no real problem with the United States over this issue. Based on what Guzzetti is doubtless reporting to the GOA, it must now believe that if it has any problems with the U.S. over human rights, they are confined to certain elements of Congress, and what it regards as biased and/or uninformed minor segments of public opinion. While this conviction exists, it will be unrealistic and ineffective for this embassy to press representations to the GOA over human rights violations. This is even more grave in its...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.